Hello, welcome to another exciting episode of Diplomatic License right here on City TV. My name is Apioko and I get to spend my second week of screen time with Jillian Hammer, who is of course the Group Chief Marketing Officer of the Data Bank Group. Now last week we had a fantastic time. We made ackee and salted fish and fried dumplings and plantain that's done the Jamaican way. We spoke about how she grew up in Jamaica, moved to Canada, and now we're going to get into really how she ended up in Ghana. We do know that love brought her here, but we'll find out exactly what the journey was like and how she settled in here. So once again, welcome. And remember the last time again that if you didn't, too bad, go to City to catch that episode. But Jillian told me that she's a fantastic table tennis player. Now I believe her because when I met her on the lawn tennis court, she beat me to shreds, tore me to shreds. Okay, but I'm going to take her up, and that's why I'm here in her house today to play some table tennis, and I'll spend some time with her. We'll have some food as well. I know she's a big foodie, so I did promise her that I'll go on a restaurant hop with her. Maybe we'll do a picnic. Who knows? Lots of things in store, but I'm ready for some table tennis. Stay tuned. Hey, you're welcome back. And Jillian has no chill. She's brought me right to the table tennis table. If you just joined us, my guest today for the second week running is Jillian Hammer. She is the Group Chief Marketing Officer of the Data Bank Group. And I had an amazing time with her last week. Learned a lot about Jamaican cuisine, Jamaican culture, and the ackee tree and the ackee fruit, which we throw away in Ghana. It's worth billions apparently, and I think we need to get into that business, you know. But we spoke about so many other things, and we continued that conversation today. But I did promise Jillian that I would take up her offer on playing table tennis, and she took me a bit too seriously. She's all geared up, and she's brought me right to the table. Hi, Jillian.
Hello, Apioko. Welcome back.
Thank you. No, yes. I'm scared.
Oh no, we're good. Well,
it's all right. It's all right. It's all right. No trophies or money at stake, so it's okay.
But I can give you a trophy. From over there. So you can take one if you do
well.
Are these
trophies you've won?
No, the kids, some are for the kids, some are for me.
It's wonderful. A family of achievers. We love it.
So I'll give you one. There's a tennis one that I'll
okay, I see this one.
Yes.
Okay. I'll take it. So we start?
Okay. Let's start.
All right. Is there a specific side? Because there's red and there's black. Does it make a difference?
So what I've learned is the red side is actually faster and the black side is a little bit slower.
Interesting.
So if you are not a super professional player, then I'm not sure it makes a big difference.
Yeah.
So pick your choice.
Oh, wow. And okay. Didn't know that. Okay. So black side is a little slower. Red yes. side is faster.
Yes.
Okay. Let's go. Oh. Already. Okay. I'm hitting it too hard. I think I'm still in lawn tennis mode. Let me calm it down. Okay. Almost. You know, the ironic thing is that my father was a table tennis champion. But
really?
Yeah, but I just, maybe I didn't get the gene, or maybe I don't practice enough.
Getting better.
Well, thank God. Okay. There's hope. There's hope.
Because we were stuck at home bored, and then we started to play last year.
All because of COVID.
All because. So a group of us in the neighborhood. Got together, and we used to play every Saturday.
The things that COVID has done, huh?
It has. It has really helped to unite.
Okay.
You're doing much better.
Progress. Mm-hmm. Okay. Maybe I shouldn't say the word progress when I say that. All right. There we go. Oh. Okay. Now it's coming.
Yeah.
Now it's coming.
There you go, see? It means you have to come for one more visit.
Yep.
And then you'll be an expert.
Yay! Yeah,
that was very good.
Thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you. You're a good teacher.
You know, I remember in Sunday school, they used to teach the children to clap.
Yeah.
Now that's very Ghanaian, because
yes,
it was a Ghanaian church that
yes,
I learned.
Yes, it
that.
Is. Oh, so they're doing it in Jamaica.
No, that was when I was in Canada.
In Canada.
The church I used to go to was Ghanaian, and we used to teach the children to clap.
And we carried the clap all the way to Canada.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So, okay. Last time, one more time. Shall we go? Oh, not the clapping, the table. Okay. Because now you are like, see?
Okay.
Two more times, and you are fully sorted.
Okay.
Yeah.
But that's just 1/100th of your Ghanaian experience.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about how you got to Ghana in the first place.
Let me get this. How I got to Ghana.
Yes. How you got to Ghana.
That is an interesting question.
You mentioned it.
My husband, yeah.
Yes, that your husband. So your husband is Ghanaian.
Mm-hmm.
For those who didn't catch this last week, Jillian's husband is Ghanaian, and I've met him. Fabulous guy, and Jillian has a beautiful story about how they met. But you did mention Jillian that he told you that whoever he marries has to get ready to go home at some point.
Yes.
You know. So let's talk about from the time you met in Canada. Mm-hmm. You got married. We spoke about your black dress. I still haven't seen it, though. I need to see
the dress. I know, I have to go and look for it.
Yeah, you know, just you wore, you know, even though black means funeral in Ghana, but in Jamaica it means elegance.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You still wore it.
Yes.
And then from there, you know, living together, you spoke about your small apartment, which you started with. But how did it all round up together? I just want us to go chronologically so that we can experience the beauty and the wonder of the story.
So how do we end up in Ghana? Well, we came, even coming to Ghana was a process in and of itself, because we knew we wanted to come. It still took us, I think, almost 2 years to from when we kind of said, okay, this is the opportunity that's come up, to when we actually meet.
You had all your kids by then.
Oh yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So all three.
So the youngest at the time, I think, was 3.
Okay.
So she, in fact, has done all her schooling in Ghana. Like, she never went to a Canadian school. But when we came, there was a lot of adjustment. And in fact, it was, I think he was a former ambassador to Canadian ambassador to Ghana that really gave us a piece of advice that helped us a lot. And what he said is that anybody who is moving, and he moved around a lot, but he says, give yourself at least 5 years before you make a decision about whether to stay or go, irrespective of where you move to. And so coming to Ghana was a huge, huge shift.
Did he give a reason why 5 years is a nice minimum?
Because he says you need time to get settled. You need time to get acclimated and understand the culture, everything. And there's a lot of upfront expense as well, a lot. So if you don't come prepared to know that you're going to spend on things you didn't think you would spend on, all of those things, you'll get discouraged and you'll go. So we came, and truly, the spending started. It wasn't pretty, because you come and you rent a house. Of course, now you need to get used to paying 1 year up front or something. In Canada, you pay a month at a time. So it's affordable, but here, it's crazy. Like, everybody has to have all of this money. No matter how much you earn, you have to have like a year's worth of money or more. So I remember we rented a house on Spintex. And the,
this was around the time you had decided that you're going to settle.
Yes.
You're in for the long haul.
Yes. So he came ahead of us, rented the house. We got here. We all came up. I think it was August 2012. And then I would go back, sell the house that we had in Canada, everything. But we were here. And of course, while the kids were here, my mom was here, Reginald was here. Somebody broke into the house while they were sleeping one night. And stole the TV, stole their backpacks, all of these things while they were sleeping. And then I think it was about a month after, again, somebody tried to break in a second time. So we left that house. But it means we had to give up all of that rent because we're only in about 4 months. Forsake that rent, rent a new house again, pay another 1 year
or so worth of rent.
And the landlord said, well, if you can find somebody to rent, then you can get your money back. But we never did. And so we never got that money back. So then we had to rent a second house. And meanwhile, now we're trying to look for a house to buy, all of those things. So it's settling in is not easy. Then there's also, I remember somebody else told me, and it worked. When you come, you can't compare. Like, you have to stop comparing your life here to what it was in any other country. Because if you keep saying, well, if I was in Canada, this wouldn't be happening or that wouldn't be happening, you drive yourself crazy. Like, really, it's not worth it. So you come, you commit, and you say, no, this is where I am. I'm going to take it as it is. It doesn't mean you're happy with everything, but you've decided that this is it. So that was really, the transition to get here was, it took quite a while. It cost a lot, but it's something that you need to push through, because I can stand here and say it was worth every minute of it. So I have no regrets at all.
And I mean, that's a very important and honest, thank you for your honesty and your openness in talking about that, because a lot of people, when they are moving back home or to the continent, you know, I imagine that some of these challenges are not particularly Ghanaian. You experience them in, you know, many different shapes and forms, wherever you find yourself on the continent. And a lot of people who want to make the move back from the diaspora, you know, and especially people who have very clear ties to, say, Ghana, for example, Ghanaians who have been away for a long time, they struggle to make the move back. Things may not be going as well as they want them to elsewhere, but in their minds, well, the system works, so I might as well stay here. So thank you for that, and for that great piece of advice from former ambassador of former high commissioner of Canada to Ghana, saying that give yourself at least 5 years. You know,
you need it.
It's interesting. It's interesting.
I don't know. One of the things that I would also touch on, and it's especially if you're moving from maybe a more developed country to a country like Ghana, or even if you're going to Jamaica or somewhere like that, but it's that whole thing as well about understanding the culture. And money is a big deal for people who come, because they also compare how much they used to make. They do the conversion and it's like, it's not working, but you can't compare. You just have to take it as, now you're in Ghana, you're earning CDs, you're spending in CDs. But anybody who is coming to Ghana, don't let any friend tell you it's cheap. Yeah. Living in Ghana is not cheap.
That's
not. Somebody used to tell me, oh, you'll go, you can get food for 2 CDs, 5 CDs. It's a lie. You don't eat kenke every day, so you can't, like, You can't live on kenke and fish every day. So because of that, you need to plan. You really, really need to plan, and you need to just accept it. But it's Ghana has a lot of opportunities. And I feel like sometimes people come from outside, like me, and we come and enjoy Ghana more than the Ghanaians that are here.
Yeah.
Like, we don't, because I've traveled, since I've been here, I've traveled to, I think, almost all of the regions in Ghana. And
out of the original 10 or the 16?
No, out of the original 10. Out of the original 10, yeah, the 16 one. Yeah, no, COVID has kept me here. But there's a lot of beauty in it, but there is a lot of preparation that needs to go into it. And mental preparation, emotional preparation, and also even the whole family dynamic, because you know it's a very different world. I feel for you when you are in, if you're living in, I'll speak for Canada, but if you're living there or even UK, US, family units tend to be just the nuclear family. You know, the husband, the wife, the kids, everything is centered around them. You don't have housekeepers, you don't have anything, so everything is just you guys. You move here, suddenly you have the school connections, the bigger family connections, all of those things. And if you're not careful, you lose a lot of the familiness that you used to have outside. So I know some people struggle with that a lot too. Like, it took us a while to get used to it, but
like always having people in your space, in your business.
Yeah.
People always expecting you to either entertain or receive them.
Yes.
But then also people expecting you to always bring yourself out for activities.
And then a lot more people want money.
Yeah, there's that.
Oh,
yeah.
Everybody. Yeah. Like, I remember I went to a restaurant. The guy who was parking my car, suddenly he was telling me he needed school fees for his brother. He needed something else for himself. Yeah. And it's just everybody. So sometimes you can't even, you don't even feel comfortable to open up to people because
you don't know who's
within
going to
a short time they'll come with a request. Those are some of the differences here. That it's a lot of people, and you get it. People need help. They're struggling. But at the same time, you would wish sometimes you could just go somewhere and nobody asks you for anything.
Yeah. Do you have situations like that? Do you recall any situations like that from Jamaica?
In Jamaica, there we used to help people, because I always remember my parents helping kids and everything. And maybe I was too young to experience it the way I'm experiencing it now. But it's just something that you really, I still am getting used to. The people, I feel like, in Jamaica who used to ask for things more were people who were like really struggling, almost people on the street kind of thing. But you'll have people, like people who have jobs in offices, everything, still asking. So it's that one, I don't know, I haven't landed fully on that one. I'm still trying to get used to it.
But that's a very important thing. You know, a lot of the time when we talk about the experiences that people have in Ghana versus where you're coming from culturally or physically even, we don't talk about some of the negative experiences. And people struggle to open up about them. But it can be very frustrating. And sometimes it even puts an unwelcome burden on you, I imagine, because it's not that you don't want to help, but you have your other obligations, your personal obligations, and because you've got your mom here as well and all that. And now you're suddenly thinking about a stranger and how you can pay his kid's school fees when you haven't paid yours yet.
That's the thing. But you know, the part that is maybe bothersome sometimes is sometimes people, the way they ask, they're not even really asking. It's almost as if they're demanding that, okay, you've met me, so now give me some
sense of entitlement.
Exactly, that's the word. And so if there was more humility in there too, the help would come. But there's this guy that I knew, and he would just send me messages, oh, mom, I need some. And when you don't send it, like, they are upset, they're angry. So it's one of those things, but I guess it's a part of the life here.
Yeah,
it is. So I adjust.
Yeah.
You help when you can, and those you can't, you just let it be.
What about, so you've been in Ghana for how long now? About 8 years.
Yes.
Right. And that's a pretty short time, if you think about it. I mean, it will seem long for you.
Yes,
but,
it does.
You know, compared to how old you are and how long you've been here. Yeah. And considering that piece of advice that told you you need at least 5 years to decide whether you even settle or not. When you hit the 5 year mark, how did you feel? What made you decide, you know, between you and your husband? Because I imagine it wasn't just the fact that your husband told you, hey, we are living in Ghana. I'm sure there are other things that you felt that came to mind that made you say, look, this is it, I'm staying.
It was by then, actually, I had found, well, I had been working at Data Bank for, I think, 1 or 2 years. Because when I came, one of my biggest fears was, what would I do? Like, I had no idea what I would come and do, which was really, really, that was a big burden for me. Because I was coming, I left a really good job in Canada. And when I was leaving, they were even saying, oh, Jillian, if you stay, we'll promote you and all of that. And I still left and I said, no, family is first. So I'm going.
And you're used to working, right, from your teen years.
So I can't stay home. I'm not one of those people who can stay home also and not work. So as soon as I came, I got involved in the kids' school and everything to also help. But at the 5 year mark, it's about that time that I think we got settled in our house. The job was settled, the kids were now in school, they had fully settled, made great friends, everything. So it wasn't like a big lights went off, but somehow around that time you just felt like, yes, you could breathe. Now everything is okay. So it was cool. I liked it. So. Are we going to play more table tennis?
Yes.
You want Are you running away from me?
Okay, okay, so ladies and gentlemen, I'm speaking to Jillian Hammer. She is the Group Chief Marketing Officer of the Data Bank Group, and it's my second week of screen time with her. We've been talking about a lot of things, and currently we're talking about her experiences in Ghana. We'll get into that. So we'll go for a break for now. We're going to play some more table tennis. Welcome back. This is still Diplomatic License on City TV. And I mean, after I was smashed to bits at Jillian's table tennis table, you know, we said, okay, you know what? We're not even going to eat. We don't have the energy. Let me bring Jillian out, because the last time I was with her last week, if you didn't catch that, you can go to City TV and take a look. She made an authentic, in fact, the national meal of Jamaica with ackee and salted fish. Amazing dish. We also had some fried dumplings and plantain on the side. You know, very, very amazing dish. But today we're at Jamrock.
Yes.
Yeah. I imagine you've been here already.
Yes, I have.
I mean, Jamaican in Ghana, you must have. Yes. You know. Now, what a lot of people may not know is that the owner of Jamrock and her husband, or I mean, they're co-owners, they do business together. But the mister is actually Jamaican, you know, so it's very authentic out here. It's not fake. He's actually from
Jamaica.
It's
proper Jamaican.
Yes. But let's talk about some of the other foods, you know, before we go back to Korea and all that. Some of the other foods that you tend to eat in Jamaica. We did speak about cocoa bread and patties, which I'm still holding you to.
I am. Please do hold me to that.
We must make it a thing in Ghana. It's too special a delicacy not to have when there are Jamaicans in Ghana. Yeah.
And there are lots of other foods, but the foods that I love personally, as I said, we have jerk chicken, which we may actually have some for lunch, I'm hoping. But we have jerk chicken, jerk pork. So jerk is the jerk seasoning is a really big, it's a big part of who we are as Jamaicans.
What goes into it?
So one of the key ingredients is a pimento berry.
Okay.
That actually gives it this, it just gives us this very unique flavor, and it adds something to it. So, and then in Jamaica, when they do it, they tend to cook it over an open fire as well. So that also helps, because then you're not, you know, anything cooked over charcoal or anything cooked over an open fire has a different flavor.
Absolutely.
It can never be the same as something done
in
on the
oven
stove. So jerk chicken and jerk pork is a big thing. I love stew chicken. We have breadfruit now. Jamaica, it's weird. It's called breadfruit, but it's not a fruit. So you actually fry it, and you put salt on it. So it's eaten, you would eat it with ackee the same way, just like the fried dumplings. Okay. You would eat breadfruit. There's a friend of mine.
So it's a kind of bread?
No, it's not bread at all. At all. It's like, it looks, it's green and round, like if you wanted to think of like a cantaloupe melon. So it's that kind of size, about this size. You tend to roast it on the fire, or you can bake it in the oven. And then once it goes through that process, which is about 2 hours,
then so it's a nice slow cook.
Yes, then you can slice it up and fry it, or some people have it baked. But it grows in Ebri. So there's a friend of ours who is Jamaican, and she lives in Ebri, and she has lots and lots of trees. So ever so often, we get that from her. So that's another unique thing that's also here in Ghana.
That we don't really
that
use.
You don't know, use. I've never heard of a Ghanaian talking about
it. I'm going to look for it.
Yes, but just don't go looking for a fruit, because it's not a fruit. And then we have something called Bami.
Bami.
Yes. Now, Bami is made from cassava.
Okay.
So it is... There's something similar to it. I wish my husband, he was here, then he could tell me the name. But we, on Sundays, he likes to buy, is it abolo?
Abolo,
yes.
Yeah.
But at the same lady who sells the abolo sells this thing, yaka. That's what it's called.
I thought as much.
Yaka.
So it's also similar to achake.
Very, very
that.
Similar. Right. So in the same way, the bami is just flat and round, and then you fry it. It's so good because inside is moist.
So do you make it into like a cassava paste kind of? Like
no,
how does
so
it work?
So it's come, just think of the yaka.
Okay.
But think of it, instead of it being a bit like a round.
Yeah. Like taking the
it's
shape of
flat,
the leaf.
Yes.
Okay.
This one, our bami is flat.
Okay.
I'm trying to think of, it's circular and flat. It's maybe about like a half inch thick. And then you just fry it as a whole.
Okay.
So delicious. So that's what we do. We try and convert yaka to bami.
To bami.
To try and get
together
some
taste.
Feeling, yes, that we're in Jamaica. But it's beautiful. And then fish, our fish, is just to die for. It's because we season our fish properly. Like here, most people, well, generally I've seen, Ghanaians just use salt. They don't use a lot of seasoning.
Well, I think it depends on what kind of fish you're doing. If you're doing just the kena, like the fried fish.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like snapper. We have
exactly,
a lot of snapper.
Yes, lots of snapper. Uh-huh. But if you were going into your tilapia and some of the other, you know, the grilled fish and all that, like you have something called the Volta perch, which is really huge.
Okay.
And you cut it up into pieces. You find it in Kando and parts of
really?
The... And in the Volta Lake. The reason why it's called the Volta Perch.
Okay.
It was actually brought from Egypt by Kwame Nkrumah.
Really?
When you were setting up the Volta Lake, yes. And then subsequently people have cultivated it.
Yeah.
And when you're doing that on an open fire, open grill, that's really seasoned. But our fish, a lot of the time, you see it either fried or smoked.
Yes, So when we fry ours, or sometimes we steam it, but when we steam it, we'll wrap it in foil, and then we'll cut up like okra, and we have these crackers. It's these Jamaican call it hard crackers. If you ask a Jamaican, they'll know. If you say Jamaican hard crackers, and you stuff the fish with the pepper, the hard crackers, and lots of seasoning, onions and stuff. Steam it in butter, then you take it out, and it's just. It's beautiful. I have to take you to Jamaica.
Yes, you do.
Like, it's just, you'll never find that anywhere else. It's
what kind of fish is it?
I'm mostly snapper.
Snapper.
Mostly
so our same
snapper.
Redfish.
Yeah.
That we
yeah.
use for komi and kina. Komi
yes.
and kina. Okay.
yeah. So those are some of my favorite foods.
That sounds really, and it's interesting to hear the connections to Ghanaian cuisine. Like the yaka one, the bami, that's just blowing my mind.
There
right
are
now.
A lot of similarities, actually. And sometimes you take it for granted. You'd almost, because you're not comparing daily, you don't realize, but there are actually a lot of similarities between Ghanaian food and Jamaican food. So it's fine. I'm happy to say I'm like, part Ghanaian now.
Yeah. What about language? I mean, when we think Jamaica, we think Patois.
Mm-hmm.
you speak Patois,
yes,
you mentioned.
So I do.
Please teach me how to say something. I mean, as basic as it may be.
Okay, all right. So let's say I was telling somebody, okay, let's say I was telling my child to pick up something off the floor, and you're telling them to pick it up. So sometimes in Jamaica, we call children, sometimes you'll call them pick me.
Okay.
So if you're talking to them and they're not listening, then you switch from their name to pick me.
Pick me.
And then you say pick me, me tell you if you take up the thing off the floor.
Pick me, me tell you if you pick up the thing off the floor.
Yes. But then you have to say it quicker, where you'll tell them that you never hear me say pick it up, and then, you know, so yes. So most times I reserve patois for when I'm dealing with them
kids
properly. Then they know that if the patois comes, yes.
Mommy's not joking.
I'm serious. I'm very serious.
But it's interesting that you mentioned that sometimes you call children pick me, because in Ghanaian pidgin, mm-hmm, and even in Nigerian pidgin as well, a lot of West African pidgin, we say pikin.
Yes, yes, similar.
Yes,
very similar.
We're talking about children, so that's very interesting.
It's nice. I like it.
Are there any other languages apart from Patois that are spoken in Jamaica?
No. Apart from English, you have Patois, but the level of Patois is different. It varies within Jamaica. So there are certain parts of Jamaica that if I go, I can't understand them, because their Patois is so deep that it's just, it's almost like a whole nother language, but it's the same Patois. So some areas it's a bit more refined, maybe more Americanized. Other areas it is like,
would that be places where that are more urban or cosmopolitan, or people are more better educated in those areas? How come?
Probably, I think maybe more like the urban areas, the more touristy areas, where you tend to have heavier tourist traffic.
Okay.
I think in many ways we've had to westernize our patois just to make it understandable and relatable to people. But if you go into some of the inner parts of Jamaica, that's where you can't understand. We as Jamaicans struggle to understand them. So it's one language, but different levels. So you know your level when you go to Jamaica.
So how would you say, we have to go, I have to take you to Jamaica one of these days. How would you say that?
Oh, may I have to take you to, it's sounding Canadian. It's not even sounding proper.
It's not sounding good.
Oh, we can say, you know, we have to go to Jamaica sometime.
We have to go to Jamaica sometime.
Yes.
We have to go to Jamaica sometime.
Yes, exactly.
I like it. You know.
So, and if there's any Jamaican out there who feels I have butchered this, forgive me.
So, is Patois documented?
Like,
is it a language that's taught in school? Can you read it, write it?
We didn't really learn
in
school. It's like, largely, I think it's treated like, very much like the vernacular here.
Okay.
Where, for the most part, schools don't focus on it. It's more spoken outside, in the homes, just in social interactions. But beyond that, we never did. I don't recall. And if even on Facebook sometimes, you know, somebody will say, yesterday I was reading a post and it says, what are the ways to say I am leaving in Jamaica? And there are about 50 or 60 different comments.
What?
And even in, we're all writing Patois, but everybody spells it slightly differently, everything. But you'd be amazed. It's just to say I am leaving. There are at least 50 different ways you could say that. So we have managed to make our language very interesting.
Yeah. What are some of those ways? So I'm leaving. I'm just curious.
So
maybe give me three.
All right. So one person said, "Mia bounce."
Mia bounce. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's like pigeon again.
Uh huh.
At a bounce.
Yes.
Or bounce. Okay. even then, now we say I'm bouncing.
Okay.
Yeah,
yes.
If you're speaking
yes,
formally.
Same.
Right?
Then another one would be, all right, I've gone, me gone now. So,
okay. I've gone, me gone now.
Yes.
Okay.
So, I'm gone.
Okay. I've gone, me gone. Okay.
Then some people would just say, later. and
later.
That's it.
Okay, so later.
No, you're gone.
Later.
Yes, so there, okay. There are so many different ways to do it.
I love it. I love it.
But it is interesting.
I love it. So let's talk a little bit about career. You started your career in insurance sales or insurance marketing.
It was right? Insurance and investments. Okay. Yes.
And you didn't like it.
No, I didn't really like it, to be honest. I'm trying to think
that
of a positive.
Be hard.
Because honestly, insurance sales is difficult. And it's difficult because the way it was structured, I don't know how it is in Ghana, but the way it was structured in Canada, I would come to you, I would sell you an insurance policy, and then the way you get paid is you get paid a commission up front. But if 30 days later or 10 days later you decide that you don't want my policy anymore and you want to go back to your old policy or something, then they cancel it and they will come back for the money.
Oh,
so the
so
money
even your commission
is not
gone.
Really yours. So wow. You have to pay it back. So,
so
it's called charge
spend
back.
Your money in peace.
So you get money and if you're not careful by the next month it's all charged back and you don't get any pay because now people who have canceled, and then you have the insurance agents, they all don't want to lose their commission. So if they realize you have taken their person, they'll come for them. So it wasn't nice at all. So that's why my husband used to tell me I wasn't making any money.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
I wasn't making any money at all.
So let's talk about how you started working with the Data Bank Group. Thank you. How you started working with the Data Bank Group. You mentioned that, so you've been in Ghana for 8 years, right? Now, you came and you weren't sure what you were going to do, because you had followed your husband.
Yep.
You know, it was all about family. You left a well-paying job, you know, which you had. So let's talk about the well-paying job that you had after not making any money in insurance sales, and then how you had to leave that and how you ended up with the Data Bank.
Okay. So we started off with that job that didn't make any money in insurance. Then after that, it was right around the same time I had gotten married. So my husband and I decided to go into business together. We actually opened up, at the time, it was a photocopy. It was a copy and a calling center. Now, context is everything. So at the time, and this was even in Canada, long distance calls were still problematic for people to make. So we
this
went.
This was around which year?
This was 1998.
Okay. So, makes sense.
Yeah.
We're still using dial up internet.
Yes, and phone cards. So we had this idea. Actually, it was my dad who even helped us. But we got the idea to set up a calling center with booths inside the business so people could come. They wouldn't have to worry about having a phone, making a long distance call from their home. They would come to us. Then we had a card system and then they could come and make the calls from our place. So we actually set it up right in the middle of the Jamaican community in Canada. And then alongside that, we would help people with their marketing needs and everything. So we did that for a year and a half and then we sold it. And then I went and got a job, like I went back to the work world, which was very painful because at the time I still felt like I should have been doing business. I wanted to be a business person, but I wasn't really making any money as a business person. And so I remember my husband, he always reminds me that when he told me to do my CV the first time and I did the interview and I told him this is the CV he made me do. So it was some of these things. They are, when I see young people struggling today, you know, you try and tell them that, guys, you have to go through a process.
Yeah.
It's a process.
And trust the process.
Yes. Yeah. And sometimes if one thing doesn't work, you do something else. So what I learned was at that time, business wasn't the right choice for us because it was costing us more and we were struggling to make ends meet. And so there's no shame in saying, okay, business is not working, let me go and actually get a paying job. So that's what I went to do. And it was back in investments. And so I worked for that company for 15 years until I left Canada. So it's only because I left Canada that I actually left the company. But in that, I did, I think, about 7 different jobs as well. So I started off in the call center. Then I was in communications, where I used to write for the employee internal communications. That company had about 900 staff. So there was a whole department just dedicated to internal employee communication. So I did that. Then I moved to marketing. I was a copywriter, editor, then project manager, then strategic planner, and all of those things until I left. Now, again, where I say there's a lesson in everything, all of those things, some of those moves that I made as well, weren't always necessarily upward moves. Some of them were sideways. Yeah. So it wasn't an increasing pay, but it was just a different experience, different job. But all of those roles that I did now came to help me get the job that I got in Ghana. So my role as chief marketing officer, I wouldn't have gotten it if I didn't have all of those skill sets to fall on. And my team that is quite large, the beauty of having done all of that is I tell them, I've done all of your jobs. So I can appreciate.
How big is your team?
So there are 120 people on the team.
Manage 120 people?
Yes.
What?
I do.
At least for the data bank group.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Wow. So we've got 19 locations, and so there are team members spread out across all of those. So there are about 110 of those. And then, so that constitutes like the sales team.
Okay.
Then I have a core marketing team that is almost like an internal ad agency.
Okay.
So I've got my graphic designer, social media person, copywriter, project managers. So it's all of those things have come together, all the experiences to help me to do this job now really, really well. So it's been quite the journey, but sometimes I see people and it's always about how much money am I going to get, or, you know, when am I getting the next promotion, or why haven't I been promoted already? Sometimes it's good, Apioko, to just work. Just do the work. The reward will come.
Yeah.
People, if you are doing really good work, people will see and they'll be willing to pay for it. That I have learned. So you can't just sit somewhere and then say, well, why am I not getting it? Do the work, add value to it. So that's what has brought me to Data Bank. And the Data Bank position was just by chance, like literally.
Ooh. Oh, it has some. Okay. Nice looking drink.
Okay. So what's this? Okay, what's inside? Okay. And then this is more of a mint.
Is that like
Virgin Mojito? So okay. I would love, you know, this is my favorite drink.
It is.
Mine too, actually.
Really?
Virgin Mojito. Yeah, it is.
I like it.
Anything with mint.
Yeah, me too. Yeah.
So even my sorrel, as you know it's called, my sorrel is, I always add mint to it.
Oh, do you? Okay.
Yeah.
I should try that.
Yeah, it's actually pretty interesting because I'm not big on ginger.
Yeah?
Yes, it gets a bit overpowering for me, so the mint is a nice kick.
Mm.
But Jillian, I want us to wrap up this conversation soon so that we can eat and, you know, chill a little bit more. But I mean, you have dropped so many nuggets of wisdom across the 2 hours of screen time that I've spent with you, 2 weekends I've spent with you. Your knowledge and your wisdom when it comes to relationships and marriage, life as a young person.
Oh, I have some marriage advice to share.
Plenty. and then your advice as a career woman.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but I'm just going to ask you, and if you could just tell us that very quickly, how have you managed? Because you've held very high profile positions. How have you managed to do with kids and a husband, and then run a successful home and marriage? How have you managed to do it?
You know what? It's one of those things that it's not easy, and it takes compromise, and it takes
sacrifice. So, and it takes a good husband as well. Mm. Honestly, you can't do it if you don't have a good partner, because you go through stages in life and in your marriage as well, where, you know, when you start out, it takes, there's a little bit of, you know, you're getting to know each other, all of those things. And then from there, you move to having kids. When the kids come, things change, because no longer is it about, you know, just the two of you. So there's a... I like the food. Sorry.
Yeah, I know.
I know, I'm getting really distracted good. By the food.
Don't worry. I know. Jillian is a huge foodie, so it's understandable.
But I was saying that, I think the way to balance it is to know that there is no perfect balance, first of all. You see people, and it may look like they have everything together, but no, something always has to give. That's the most important thing I think people need to know. And so if your kids are young, they become the priority. Suddenly a little bit of your couple relationship has to give. Or you have to find different ways to do it. But you can't have everything. And when it comes to career, there may be times that, you know, your husband's career may be moving ahead, so you have to kind of pace yourself. And then there are other times yours is moving ahead. And the key is, you support each other. You don't make one person feel threatened you shouldn't feel threatened because somebody else is doing well. So it's the whole balance thing. It's always like something that you're going after. But the key is to recognize that there are different stages in marriage and in life and in work. So what was good 5 years ago won't be good today, because things change and you have to understand and appreciate that. But it's tricky. I think what I recommend is that even though you don't have balance, you have to make time. And so do things like go on dates with your husband. Before COVID, we used to go to the movies a lot. So that used to be one of our things. Now, sometimes, like once a month, we try at least. We'll go have drinks at one of the hotels by the beach. So you can hear the water, all of those things.
Because the beaches are so close.
Yes, kind of yes, thing. Yes. So those are some of the things you do to try and bring a bit of balance where there is no perfect balance. But it's tricky sometimes. And the kids, you always have to find a way to make them feel like they have their time. So like my son, he's 17 and...
He's your second child.
He's my second child.
And your only boy.
My only boy. And for him... Quality time with me is me sitting down and watching one of his anime shows with him.
Yeah, we were in the house and we saw his anime.
So,
oh wow.
Every evening, from morning, he will send me a message on Telegram. So, Mom, how many episodes are we watching today? And I'm like, Ethan, I don't have time. But I have to find the time, because if you don't, then all the work that you're doing, everything, is not worth it if your kids feel like you've abandoned them at the end. So it's a tightrope that you walk from time to time. And then you try and balance it with work and giving your best at work and doing everything there. It's not easy, actually.
No,
it's not easy. One of the things that I have observed, I don't know, there's this generational difference where I feel like the older, I'm even referring to me, even though I'm not that old, but, you know, somehow I find that the younger generation coming up, they don't want to work as hard. Like, it's just, there's this thing that they everybody's in pursuit of title and fame and money without putting in the time. And so one of my favorite books, it's a book called
Outliers
by Malcolm Gladwell. I love that book so much. But he talks about 10,000 hours and being willing to do your 10,000 hours. we have to be willing to do our 10,000 hours, whether it is at work, in marriage, in whatever it is. Like, nothing will just get up and happen.
You must put in the work and the time.
You have to. You absolutely have to. So that's one of the kind of principles that I live my life by every day. Every day.
Very, very beautiful. Beautiful. So we need to enjoy this food.
Okay.
We're going to go for a break. Viewers, if you're watching us or you just joined us, this is Diplomatic License on CTTV. My name is Apioka. My guest today, the second week running, is Jillian Hama. She is the Group Chief Marketing Officer of the Data Bank Group. And we've been talking over the past 2 weeks about her life, her experiences, her Jamaican background, her Canadian in the mix, coming to Ghana, mm-hmm. Ghanaian husband, I mean, everything in between. It's been very interesting. And she's been teaching me a lot of things that are actually very important to Jamaican cuisine, which we have in Ghana in abundance, but we just don't know that they're worth gold. So we'll go for a break and we'll be back. Welcome back. This is still Diplomatic License on CTTV, and my name is Apioko. And I'm just wrapping up my 2 weeks of screen time with Jillian Hama, who is, of course, the Group Chief Marketing Officer of Data Bank Group. And we're here at Jamrock. Shout out to Eliza, because I said I was bringing Jillian out for lunch at Jamrock. And Eliza says, you know what, just take the food for free. I mean, like, you're
that's
coming
amazing.
Home. It's cool. And we love you, Eliza. Thank you so much.
Eliza.
Love you. Love you. Love you. Love you. But we have interesting things here. So there's rice and peas.
Yes.
And I've been warned not to say rice and beans.
Yes.
When I'm with a Jamaican.
Peas.
Rice
Thank
and
you.
Peas. But, I mean, it looks like wachi.
It does, but it's not as clumpy as wachi.
Okay.
It's looser. So looser. You'll find that if you take the fork and you try to take a bite, it will just almost fall off the fork.
So it's pretty much same preparation as wachi. Is it the peas that give it the color?
And we don't. Yes, the peas give it the color. So we don't use that leaf that they use for the wachi here.
Okay.
But delicious.
So you just boil the rice with the peas and then you
so
get
you boil the
color.
Rice, add the peas. Some people add coconut milk to it to give it a bit of a creamy texture.
Okay.
But that one can make you put on a lot of weight.
Ha ha ha.
You can stay away from the coconut milk.
To take your time with
that.
Okay, then we have oxtail stew. Mm-hmm. Now we have a lot of oxtail in Ghana, apparently, and we don't eat it. It's also something we don't eat, just like ackee and breadfruit.
Yes.
We don't eat it.
Just like when I'm in Canada, you pay a fortune for oxtail.
Yeah, oxtail
here,
is
it's here, and people throw it away. Like, they don't use it here. So, yes, so that's oxtail.
Okay. And then we've got Jamrock rice, special. And I see that there must be, I think it's curry.
Yes.
That they've used, right? I know Jamaicans love curry.
We do.
But there's also curry chicken
stew,
right? And then we have kalalu. Mm-hmm. Now, this is another interesting one.
Looks very similar to your kontom. Right?
Yes, it does.
But it's just, so, and again, it grows, it can grow here, but a lot of people don't grow it here.
Okay.
So, but it's, you eat it with salted fish, very similar to the ackee and the salted fish.
Okay.
You can take out the ackee and replace it with kalalu.
Okay.
And you're good.
So then that's almost like doing consumer without palm oil. Maybe our boom without, you know, sometimes we just don't want to add the oil to the consumer.
Yeah,
it happens.
Yeah.
You have the fish
and
in
you
there.
Get this. Just add some onion seasoning and it's
some
good.
Tomatoes in there.
Yes.
But not as a stew.
And if you'll notice, with Jamaicans, we don't boil the tomatoes. You know, like you guys cook the life out of the tomatoes.
Most of our stews and soups are heavily tomato-based.
Our tomatoes, so you'll still see a lot of it is intact. The tomato itself is still intact because we don't overcook it. Like, you just gently cook it and then it's
That's
there.
That's brilliant. And then, of course, we have our plantain.
Woo!
But it's cut for the Ghanaians.
Yes.
Yes, the way we cut it. So that when you come, you don't run away. It's cut for Ghanaians. But again, if you missed my episode with Jillian last week, she taught me how Jamaicans cut their plantain. Very slim. Almost like the long plantain chips that you see on our roadside being sold, but thicker.
Yes.
You know, we caught that. Okay, so it looks like a spread and we need to eat.
We need to eat. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much
Cheers.
For spending all this time with me.
Yes.
Thank you so
all
much.
All right.
Very grateful.
So time to eat.
It is time to eat. So let me wrap this up with you right now so that we can go and eat our food. And once again, thank you to Eliza, Jamrock. You guys are awesome. We need to finish this food as soon as possible and get on with life. Hopefully I can still stay awake after we eat it. But I've been spending my time over the past 2 weeks with Jillian Hammer, and once again, she's the Group Chief Marketing Officer of the Data Bank Group. And it's been a joy to learn from her so much about Jamaica, about Canada, about Jamaican living in Canada, about love and life and marriage and everything in between, and also about coming into Ghana and, you know, looking at some of the similarities between Jamaica and Canada and Ghana and in between. I mean, she's a whole mood. She's a whole mood. And Jillian, I am going to take you up once again on that cocoa bread and patty business.
Yes, we have to sort that one out.
We have to do that. We have to do that. Shout out to there's a very handsome gentleman here at Jamrock who moved to Ghana just a year and 2 months ago. He came when lockdown, like he came with lockdown. He brought it.
He brought it, yes.
And I'm very, very, very excited that he's here with us. He's served this up to us. Thank you all so much. This is Diplomatic License, and I will see you again next week. My name is Apioko. Don't forget, hashtag Diplomatic License. And do let us know if there's anybody you want to see on the show. Stay in touch. Join all the conversations and then just learn. It's always great to learn about different cultures, the diversity of people around the world, because hey, we are all one.